God is so worthy on today. Amen. At this time, Brother Deshaun is going to come and he's going to lead us. Amen. And I will praise and worship on today. Amen. This is one of the co-workers of our preacher for today, Sister Jamil. Amen. So give Brother Deshaun some love as he comes today. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, today we're going to have a great time in God. What we're going to do is we're going to set the atmosphere. So when Ja'Mell comes in here, the host is already here. It is when Jesus steps in that everything else that's not supposed to be has got to get out. So we're going to make sure that we welcome God in together. We're going to be the praise team together, just as King Jehoshaphat and his team of people will enter Mount Seir and Ammon and all those other tribes that tried to come and kill them. So together, where one is, we bring, what is it? Where one is, 100 goes to fight. Where two is, 10,000 goes to fight. So if all of our praises are raised together, billions of demons have got to flee. So together we're going to bless his name and lift his name and declare that he's good and his mercy is good forever. Come on, put your hands together. Your mercy enduring forever. Hallelujah. Here we go. Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good.
Oh, meet us right where we are, individually. One of the misconceptions that we have is that when God comes, that he may have just missed us. And that's not because God isn't able. That's not because God doesn't do all things well. It's only because the atmosphere within ourselves didn't allow us to receive what God has for us. So in this time of praise and worship, I just feel led to share this. In this time of praise and worship, we must understand that praise and worship is simply a time for us to get our mind focused on God. It's not about the song so much. It's not about the way we sing. It's not about those things. But it's when we begin to make God great in our mind that the impossible becomes possible. That's all praise and worship is about. Making sure that we say, God, you're great, and we believe it. And then God meets us right where we need him. Amen.
Amen. And now my expectation is God is going to push us deeper into his presence. Amen. I know that many can't be here. Amen. I'm going to preach our first sermon on today, but I come with a spirit of expectation that God will be on that. Amen. I expect for the Holy Spirit to move in such a way that his anointing is going to set somebody free. Somebody going to be restored. Amen. As you preach this message on today. Amen. Somebody's going to be renewed in their faith. Amen. At this time, our mother's going to come up. Sister Jackie's going to come. Amen. And give us our welcome on the day. Amen. Give us a love.
Ordination to you.
because of you.
God,
I
want to be where you are.
Oh, I sing that again.
I want to be where you are.
be the missionary prayer breakfast. A couple weeks ago, one of the things that God spoke at the end of that prayer breakfast, He said it was going to be a season of transition.
Yes.
And God spoke to me and said that it's not going to be church as usual. I know we all came to hear the Lord preach our first sermon. But God told me, I leaned down and told Pastor Washington, I said, the word of God hadn't even went forth yet. I said, the song is already getting what God has for me. Hallelujah. And then the Holy Spirit said that there are some that's still preaching. Because you're waiting for the preaching. Amen. But God is already preaching. Amen. So don't wait on what you think God has for you and miss in the process of what God is already doing for you. Amen. Just let go of that God. Just let go of that God. Amen. At this time, Pastor Washington, amen, which is the uncle of our beloved daughter, is going to come. And I just thought it would be fitting, amen, that he will come as also as a son of this house, as Amos Temple. Amen. So, biologically, that's his niece. But spiritually, she's about to become his sister in the ministry. Amen, amen. So let's give Pastor Washington, he's a pastor of St. Paul, City Church, in Fresno, California. Amen. Give some love. Oh, come on, give the Lord a great big hand clap of praise. I'm saying, give me a hand clap of praise. I said, give the Lord a great big hand clap of praise. He is worthy to be praised. Have I got any witnesses in this place on today? How many of us show that I have a reason to praise the Lord on today? Oh, I need to check the crowd. How many of us show that I have a reason to praise the Lord? Let me ask you, how many of us show that I have a reason to praise the Lord? Let me just check the crowd. I'm not wearing my glasses, but how many of us on this place show that I have a reason to praise the Lord? Listen, Lord, the great big man clap of praise. Hasn't God been good to you? Hasn't He been faithful? Hasn't He been just? Been gracious? Hasn't God been merciful? Hasn't He been a healing God? Hasn't He opened up some doors for you? Hasn't He been closed some doors that should not have been in the open in the first place? Have I got a witness? Hasn't He made a way for somebody? Hasn't He been your bridge over troubled water? Hasn't He been your Savior, your Redeemer, your fortress, your high tower? All that and even more. Now do me one more thing. Not for me, but for Him. Give the Lord just one more.
I certainly count it a privilege and an honor, amen, to be able to stand before God's people, amen, in tiptoe anticipation, and I'm certainly hippopotamus happy to be able to stand before you for this easy task. And that is one that introduces the one that will break bread for us on today. I must say this, that through prayer and fasting and also praying, she has certainly heard from the Lord. And the reason why I know that she has heard from the Lord, hallelujah, is because she has an intimate, personal, and private relationship with Him. And oftentimes it is that we hear the voices of somebody else. But oftentimes it is that we have to ask God to just make it plain. And even in the midnight hour, Jamil heard the voice of the Lord. And she said, Lord, I surrender. She said, yes, Lord. I would go where you would have me to go. Yes, Lord, I would do what you would have me to do. Yes, Lord, I would preach in season and out of season. Yes, Lord, I would pray when I don't even feel like praying. Have I got some witnesses in this place today? She comes from a background of family that are prayer warriors. Her grandfather is certainly a prayer warrior because he is certainly a testimony. As he sits before us, amen. But the doctors want to say that they are doing the town and giving up. I leaned over in that hospital bed, amen. He told me, he said, God is not through with me. So she comes from a lineage of prayer warriors. Her grandmother, my mother, she's a prayer warrior. one easy task for me to actually introduce to you and present to some others, amen, the one, Minister Ja'Mell Fairley. I am certainly excited, and I do believe this, I decree, and I also declare right now in the name of Jesus that her life after this day will never be the same. Yeah. I've got some witnesses in this place today. Amen. So I ask that you elevate your right hand. Elevate your right hand. Amen. Because there's power in unity. Amen. And if somebody can't elevate their right hand, perhaps they got some arthritis, raise it up anyway. Hallelujah. And say, preach the word. Somebody ought to say, preach the word. Turn to one, somebody say, neighbor. I don't know about you, but I need to hear a word from the Lord. Now give the Lord one more great big hand clap of praise with the hands that you lifted up. Hallelujah.
Sean is going to come. Amen. They're going to bless us. And afterwards, we will hear what God has for us in this house on today through this preacher. Amen.
Amen.
Expose himself to us. He still wants to expose himself to us because some of us are holding back. We're still holding back a bit. So we're going to spend some time saying, God, I'm available. God, I'm here for you. That I release myself. And I'm doing it all for your glory. I was thinking of another song, but we're going to stay right here. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, to reward your end. For your glory.
can just be selfish just for a little bit. I need I like to say, how wrong are you? But I don't think that's correct. by Paul as an urgent letter to the church to the people of Corinth. Now, Corinth at this time was this thriving city. People came in and out of Corinth. It was a city full of alcohol, prostitution, and many bizarre religions were practiced. And the Christians that settled there, they tried their best to live right, but they were often distracted by the things that happened around them. And this reminds me a lot of the cities that we reside in today. But Paul wrote this letter to help the people of Corinth come back to the ways of Christ and to transform their lives, but only through Jesus Christ. Now, in chapter 13, where we are now, it's speaking about love. We all know about love. He's speaking about the characteristics of love, what love is, what it isn't, what it does, what it doesn't do. But it's safe to say that we've all experienced love in some form of our lives, whether it be love for another person, love for a pair of shoes, love for a sports team, go Warriors, love for a child, and a love for a toy. We've all experienced love at some point. But when we look at verse 11, when I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, but when I became a man, I put ways of childhood behind me. You would think, what is this verse doing in a chapter of love? Right? Anybody else? That's what I thought when I read. What is this doing in this chapter full of love? I'm here to tell you it has everything to do with love, but I wrote the question earlier, how grown up are you? Naturally, your response would be, oh, you know, I'm such and such years old, the X amount of years in which you've been living on this earth. But when I ask you this evening, how grown are you, I'm speaking at a spiritual standpoint. How grown are you? Are you a babe in this walk? Are you experienced, or are you something I like to call seasoned saint? How grown are you? If you can think back to your childhood or childhood in general, I would ask people, how was your childhood? And many people, not all people, but they would say it was a good time of their lives because there wasn't much responsibility, right? But when I think of my childhood, even though my childhood was right there, I like to think of my uncle. He used to always tell me, I don't know, my nickname is Mimi. I don't know why they just say me instead of Mimi, but they'd be like, me. He was like, me. Really enjoy this time in your life. Enjoy your childhood. Just really take hold of it. And at that time, I understood what he meant because he was getting old. But, but it wasn't until I had growth where I really understood what he meant. Some growth had to be taken place before I truly understood what he said and what he meant. But in childhood, I don't think there are many responsibilities, but there's more so expectations. Like, a child is expected to play. A child is expected to go to school. A child is expected to listen and follow instruction from their parent and or adult. A child is expected to grow. Yeah. Now, the last thing to grow, that expectation really tickled me because growth is very important in a child's life, but it's something that happens naturally. Whereas the other expectations to play, to go to school, to follow instruction is something that might need to be emphasized. But physically, growth happens naturally, but we can't say the same spiritually. Now, as I spoke earlier, how grown are you? Our growth question, how grown are you? I started to really think about the Church of Corinth and the similarities that they had with the cities that we reside in today. And as my pastor would say, we are living in a very dark and broken world. Very dark and broken. But I'm here to tell everyone that just because some of us are Christians and we do right, it does not mean that we are not affected by everything that's happening around us. Our world is louder than ever before. Our families are broken. Our mothers are angry. Our men are angry. Children are confused and misguided. But my question to you is, with all the sounds of chaos and trouble, how many of us actually, honestly, seek God's voice? With all the distractions, with all the silence, with all the gunshots, with all the crime, how many of us actually stop to try to hear the sweet, peaceful sound of God's voice. I'm here to tell everyone that it is time for spiritual growth. It is time for spiritual maturity. The world needs love. The world needs God's love, and it is time for spiritual growth. I have 4 points this evening to assist you in spiritual growth. Number one is to call it out.
Amen.
You have to call it out. Realize that it's easy to become comfortable and come to the decision that it's time to grow. When I was a child, if you can think about this with me, just walk with me. There's this child, this boy, he wants this truck. He's like, Mommy, Daddy, I need this truck. Give me this truck. He gets it for Christmas, and once he gets it, you know, children, they're really excited when they get new things. So he's taking it to the doctor's office. He's bathing with it. He's in the mud. He's eating with it. This is his toy. This is his number one toy. Nobody can take it. The other toys don't matter. This is his number one toy. But what happens is a few months later, the wheel breaks. His favorite toy. Look at the other toys. He's broken just like this truck. Favorite truck is broken. What does he do? The first thing a child will do is go to his parents. Go to his father. Daddy, can you fix this for me? I need this fixed. What happens in our lives when we're broken just like that toy? We got comfortable. God has been blessing me. Hallelujah. I'm going to church every day, but life comes and it shakes you up. What happens when you have this job and you've been working it for an X amount of years and life comes and shakes you up? Majority of us, what do? We try to fix it ourselves instead of going to our Father to fix it for us. It is time for spiritual growth. You have to seek something greater than your situation, so you must come to the decision that it's time to grow. The scripture says, when I became a man, I put away childish things. I looked up the word put. In the Greek language, it means to separate. When I became a man, I put away childish things. This also helps me realize that as grown as you want to be, you can still be childish. When I became a man, I put away childish things. Get your mind right and grow with God. Call it out. Tell your neighbor and say, call it out. Get your mind right. Get your mind right. Amen. Number two, give more. God wants more. Your spirit wants more. God wants more time with you. He wants more time in prayer. And this goes beyond your morning prayer. This goes beyond the prayer before you go to sleep at night. God wants more time with you. And not only that, this goes beyond the prayer that you were taught as a child. Thank God for auntie, cousin, and them from Mississippi that taught you that prayer when you were young. But it is time for more. God is wanting more. It is time for more. Put a word on it. Add some scripture to it. And this leads me to, what are you watching? Pastor Morris, what are you listening to? Who are you around? I said Pastor Morris because he dipped into my sermon last week. What are you watching? What are you listening to? Who are you around? God spoke to me the other day. I don't watch much television, but I was watching TV, and for some reason I always gravitate towards reality TV. Pray for me. Pray for those things. But I was watching it, and God said, I'm not in it. Reality TV, and God is the realest thing I know, and I can't find him in this show. So what am I saying? I'm saying stop feeding your spirit junk and feast on the word of God. Who are you around? My mom and my brother can tell you, I come home with different personalities every day, and that sounds bad, but listen to me. I come home with different personalities every day. Why? Because I work with children throughout the week. I pick up their goofiness. Sometimes I find myself whining, and my mom's like, you've been around your kids. And so what am I saying with that? Pay close attention to who you're spending your time around, because you can easily pick that stuff up and take it home. And you're bringing that into your personal space. Now that's something that you have to deal with. So spend more time with God. The more time you spend with him, the more you become like him. God gave us his all. why is it so hard for us to just give him just a little bit more? He gave his all, and we can't give a little bit more. Number three, be childlike and not childish. There is a complete difference between the two. Though we desire to separate ourselves from our childish ways, we should remain childlike. Luke 18 and 17 says, truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. Being childlike reveals to God humility and dependence. God is our Father, He is our Creator, He is our Provider. When He sees us operating in a childlike manner, rather than a childish manner, it shows Him that we trust and that we need Him in all aspects of our lives. When I'm in worship, I often lift both of my hands, not only as an act of surrender, but I like to think that God is looking down on me as His child. And my hands are raised and I'm saying, God, pull me and lift me out of the situation that I am. Take me higher with you where you can hold me and you can show me everything that you see. And I'm able to look over the part that I was in, to look over the situation that I was in down below. Be childlike and not childish. Amen. Number four, lastly, keep growing, don't die. Keep growing, don't die. We have the most interesting obstacles to overcome as Christians. Has anybody realized we have the most interesting obstacles to overcome as Christians? We will have problems. We will have obstacles. But we can overcome them. Why? Because God overcame death. We can overcome these things. We have to continue to keep pressing. You have to continue to surround yourself with other believers and other people that are seeking growth and the promises of God. The only thing that can keep you from growth is death. You will not continue to grow, just like physically. You cannot continue to grow if you die. Continue to grow and don't die. Verse 11, when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. This verse has everything to do with love. And please listen to me. Steps to spiritual growth reflects the love that you have for God. Steps to spiritual growth reflects the love that you have for God. When you really love someone, how many people have really been in love with somebody? Just wave your hand. Okay, I thought I was the only one for 2 seconds. When you're really in love with God, you don't mind doing things, or just even with somebody. When you're really in love, you don't mind calling it out. You don't mind giving more. You don't mind being childlike and showing humility. You want to live and you want to grow, and death is not an option. You don't mind calling it out, I love you, Jesus. You don't mind giving more. You don't mind being childlike and showing humility. God, I need you right now. I can't do it by myself. You want to live and you want to grow. Death is not an option. God wants a stronger relationship, and if He didn't, He wouldn't have sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, to tear the veil that once separated us from His presence. God wants to be closer. Love is mature. Love is mature. God spoke to me when I was working on this. God said, love is mature. Love is fully developed. Love is fully grown. And because of that, I'm still growing spiritually and in love. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I'm talking in past tense. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I spoke just to speak. There was no reason behind my words. But now I'm speaking things into existence. I'm speaking life into presumable dead situations. Different, and I know it's a part of my master's plan. I know that my words have power because He until I sought him for myself. God had to isolate me. I had to give him more for me to fully understand the presence of God. And today I'm grateful because he waited for me. Y'all hear me? When I was in my childish ways, God said, you know what? You have purpose and I'm going to wait for you. Who does that? God does that. He loved me. God wants to be closer. Family, God wants to be closer. It's always been like this. This is not something new. It started in the beginning in the Garden of Eden. It was just God and man in his presence. But what happened? Just like everything that happened in Corinth, everything that happened that's happening today, Eve got distracted by everything that was around him. Eve got distracted. God wants you to be in his presence. God sent Jesus in human form as another example of his presence. And then later when Jesus died on the cross, the veil tore. It was the veil that separated man and the presence of God. God wants you to be in his presence. God loves you. Spiritual growth is very important, but relationship is everything. So I ask the question again, how grown up are you? And do you want to grow in love, in the love of God? How grown up are you?
Still scattered. Perhaps there may be one that is in this house home today, and after listening to this message, perhaps you have found out that you're not as grown as you thought you were. And the preachers told us today that we can grow in his love. And because God shared his love through his son Jesus, we don't have to stay where we are. But we too can grow in an eternal relationship with the Father. She said, the first thing that you have to do is call it out. She said, you got to be real with yourself. Acknowledge where you are in the eyes of God. And perhaps there's one here today that you're not saved. Call it out. The Bible said that we all have sinned and come short of his glory. Call it out. Don't worry about what the person in front of you, the person next to you, the person behind you may think. Call it out. And establish that eternal relationship with the Father. And then she says, and don't be childish, but be childlike. Perhaps you're here today and you're saved, but through this message on today, that perhaps you see God has revealed that there's some childish ways in your relationship with the Father. And perhaps you're saved, but we want to give you that opportunity to come to the altar, and because we believe that through the power of prayer that the Lord is able to help you to become more childlikeness rather than to be childish. Perhaps there's one here today. Number three, he said, you got to keep growing. Perhaps there's one today listening to this word that God has spoken through the woman of God, that you found that you're at a standstill in your relationship with the Father. And you want to grow in that relationship. You don't want to stay where you are. You don't want the same problem that got you this year continue to get you next year. But you want to be able to grow in your relationship.
The things that got you this year won't affect you next year. But the word of God said that you gotta keep growing. Just being saved is not good enough. No matter how long you've been in the church, you gotta keep growing. And Paul is saying you got to examine yourself on today. And as you examine yourself, God wants you to ask yourself a question. Am I really growing the way I know that the Lord desires for me to grow? Or am I at a standstill? I preach every Sunday, but am I really growing personally? I'm a leader in God's church. I know how to carry out my leadership responsibility, but am I growing personally? I worship in worship service every Sunday, but am I really growing in my personal relationship? And if you're at a standstill, if you're not growing the way that you know that God desires for you to grow, we just want to pray with you. We just want to pray with you. That God will give you the strength, that God will give you the courage, that regardless of the trouble that comes in your life, that Paul says sometimes is kept all around you, that it won't stop you from growing. That's what the preacher was saying when I was a child. Past tense. I put away the childish thing, but then I became a man. Ask yourself a spiritual question. Don't worry about what the next person think about you. Am I really growing the way that the Lord desire for me to grow? And if that answer is not yes, I challenge you to meet me on this altar. I challenge you to meet me on this altar. And we're going to ask God to help us to grow. Because regardless of your classification, regardless of your position, regardless of how many letters behind your name, he didn't promise it was going to be easy. And sometimes in your Christian walk, sometimes the enemy will hit you with a low blow and it'll cause you to become at a standstill. Everybody else around you think you really got it going on. But you know. You're not really where the Lord wants you to be. You gotta keep growing. You gotta keep growing. Why don't you help me do this invitation and grab your neighbor hands and just ask them a spiritual question. Are you growing? And if you're not growing the way that you know you need to grow, I want you to just squeeze their hand. I want you to squeeze their hand. I hear God talking. I want you to squeeze their hand. And if that person's hand that you're squeezing, that person's hand that you're holding, if they begin to squeeze your hand, I want you to immediately just begin to pray for them. I want you to just begin to pray for them. You don't have to know what it is that's going on that's hindering them from growing the way they know they should be growing and God desired for them to grow. But if they squeeze your hand, just begin to lift them up in prayer. Just begin to utter unto the Lord in prayer. Don't worry about what's going on around you. Don't worry about what's going on around you. I hear God say it's a season of transition. Just begin to pray for that person. Just begin to pray for that person. Because the reality is, stop all of us from growing. And if we're all honest today, that we all have experienced some low blows in our life.
You got to keep growing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Don't have to fall against the dark. Be the plan we decree is going to hinder him, it's going to stop him, but they're going to keep growing. They're going to keep growing. Help them to grow in your will. Help them to grow in your ways. Even in the tough times, even in the midst of the challenges of life, God. Even when it seems that they can't take anymore, they can't handle anymore, God. Lord, deep down within, we ask that you allow the Holy Spirit to stir them up, oh God, that they won't quit, God, that they won't give up, that they won't throw the towel, God, but they'll keep pushing, they'll keep pressing, God.
You got to continue to grow in your will and grow in your way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God a hand.
Worship the Lord in the spirit of getting on today. But this worshiping in the spirit of giving is unto the Lord. But Paul said in Philippians chapter number 4, when Paul was in the Philippian jail, the Bible said that the Philippian church prayed for him. They visited him. But then Paul said that they brought him a love offering. Hold it down. Brought him a love offering. And Paul said, I've learned to be content in every situation that I'm in. Paul said, I learned to live without, I learned to live with. But the Bible said that he took the offering, not for his own sake, but the Bible said that he took the offering so that God may add to their account. The Bible says more of a blessing to give than it is to receive. This offering on today is not an offering for Amos Temple. This offering on today is a love offering for the preacher.
Amen.
Traditionally, in our church, when a preacher preached their first sermon,
yes,
that they would take up an offering, a love offering, and give it to the preacher. And the purpose of that offering is not trying to pay a preacher. That's not what we're trying to do. But they gave the preacher an offering for the purpose to help the preacher have a good start in their ministry. And what are you talking about, a good start? So they can go and buy tools to work with. Anybody know anything about mechanics? A good mechanic have the right tools. And the same thing is with a preacher. If a preacher don't have the right tools, in other words, if they don't have study material. And so we want to take up an offering on today, not trying to pay the preacher, but we want to sow into this preacher's ministry. And the Bible says in Philippians 4 that when they sowed into Paul said, I received this not for my sake, but so that God may add to your account. Hello, Amos. Sometimes God will set you up to be blessed. And that's one of the things, not only are we going to bless this preacher to buy tools,
that she may have tools to work with in the ministry, but also that we're going to set ourselves up as children of God so that God can pour his blessings over the limbs. The reason why some of us can't be blessed by God because we don't ever want to be a blessing. This is our call, y'all. God is setting us up on today, Amos tell us.
Yes, sir.
And as we pull and bless the woman of God to be a blessing in the ministry, God in return is going to be a blessing to each of us in our personal ministry. Amen. So at this time, we're going to turn into the hands of our usher.
It's our rise, bring forth your offering.
If you're making out checks, then you can make it out to Ja'Mell Fairley.
And he gives them, we give a body God, we ask.
then Jesus made me clean. All those things were not a pure bit of blood that said we got this help. Amen.
At this time, I'm going to ask that Sister Turner, which is the chairperson of our school board, amen, will make this presentation on behalf of the Amos Temple and the body on today.
Sister Jamil, on behalf of Amos Temple, we would just like to present you with this love token. Our hearts are truly blessed and touched, and you are truly blessed to touch each of us today. So therefore, watch you growing up in the little one and out there in the first service. I was honored to be here and be a part of that. We love you so much.
Amen. And our prayer is that God is going to, amen, is you're going to use it, amen, for the building of God's kingdom. Amen. We're believing that God is going to bless each of us 100-fold, amen, for sowing, amen, into his servant's ministry. Sister Jamil, we're going to ask you to stand one more time.
Amen.
In our custom of ours, the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church of the Quarter Conference, it goes to the church conference and then to the quarter conference when one is presented by the presiding elder to present that individual with their local preacher's license.
Yes.
Amen. And since God has given me the great privilege not only to be your proud pastor, but also a proud presiding elder as well. And so on behalf of the Amos Temple Church and on behalf of the presiding elder of the Oakland District and the Oakland District, we want to present this local preacher's license at the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. Local preacher's license has been confirmed by the local church quality conference that this certificate is issued to Ja'Mell Fairley as a local preacher in the Amos Temple Christian Methodist Episcopal Church of Oakland, California. So we present these cards. At this time, we have remarks, and we're not going to try to hold you long, but I know that we have remarks from the grandmother. Give the grandmother some love.
Not to hold the crap, but a man of God.
time of day that he gave him a little talk. And I told him about my father and everything, and only Jesus said that. She said, yes, he would just say, when I was coming up, he would just sit there and smile. And I didn't know that he could even talk until one time he just opened up to her. Told my mom one day when my mom was there with us and she was kind of ill. She told my mom, don't worry, Grandma, I'll take care of you. And she was a proud child then, so I knew then that the Lord was with her. And to Ja'Mell, Grandma is so proud. And I knew the Lord would give me a little something.
For coming. It really means a lot, and I love you all.
continue to pray for me as I continue to pray for you, and we can all grow in love.
Amen. Sister Jamila has some more family. We want all of our family to stand up. Amen. Amen. But this time, we're going to take this time to. There's a chord on that floor right there. Amen. I will live by the best of this. This class is Pastor Washington to come back and give us our closing prayer, bless our food, as well as our closing prayer. Amen. 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 Let us stand. Grab your neighbor's hand as we go out in unity and as one. Let us bow our hands. Father God, we thank you again, oh God, for your presence in this place. Oh God, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. Father God, even as we grab hands, even as we anticipate on leaving this place, oh God, we ask that you not depart from our spirit. Oh God, even as we hold each other's hand, oh God. Lord, we certainly believe in the power of prayer. We certainly believe, oh God, that you are the God that is able to walk on the water, even in the midst of our storms, and speak one word, peace be still. Lord, we thank you for your children. We thank you for everyone that is present. Oh God, and we pray that your word that has went forth, that it shall not return void, but yet it shall accomplish what to it is sent. Oh God, we decree and we declare now that the blood of Jesus Christ is dripping upon everyone, even as I speak. And Father God, we thank you for what you have done in this place. But Father God, even as we leave this place, we ask, oh God, that you would give us boldness like no other, that we will go out into a dying world and tell somebody about Jesus Christ that is still able to heal, deliver, and set free. And Father God, we thank you right now. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, may it rest with us. May it rule over us. May it abide down deep within each and every one of us. And Father God, we ask that you would bless this food that we're about to receive. Oh God, Lord, we just feasted on spiritual food. Now bless this physical food that will be nourishment to our bodies. And the people of God said amen. Amen. And the people of God said amen. Amen. And the people of God said amen. Amen. Somebody ought to just say thanks be to God. The Lord of every man, clap and praise you. Just don't line up in here. Come down and know that it's out to come. Come up and shake, give a hug. Amen. And let it know that you're